we all understood the concepts, and then next we'll move on to the next session, that is the conservation of forests and wildlife in India. So we understood what are the reasons for the depletion of this flora and fauna, that is forest and the wildlife. So how we can conserve these things, or how we can conserve the flora and fauna, what is the responsibility of society, or what is the responsibility of we to protect this wildlife. See the methods of conservation we can see here. One it is the Wildlife Protection Act we can start, and one more it is establishment of reserves and project for specific animals. So these are all the things we started for conservation, the methods of conservation. One it is Wildlife Protection Act, establishment of reserves and project for specific animals. For example, we can see that is Project Tiger. So this is one of the examples we can see. Yes. First one, conservation of forest and wildlife in India. What are the things we started here? In the 1960s to 1970s, conservationists demanded for a national wildlife protection program. So in India, what happened in the year of 1960 to 1970, the many people, you know, who are interested towards the conservation, the conservationists demanded for the national wildlife protection program. So with the result, the Indian Wildlife Act was implemented in 1972 with various provisions for protecting habitats. So to protect the wildlife, or protect the wildlife habitats, you know, in the year of 1972, the Indian Wildlife Act has been implemented. And the next third point, the central and many state government established national parks and wildlife sanctuaries. So with the idea of, you know, the protecting of this, you know, the wildlife, they started with some national parks and even the wildlife sanctuaries from, you know, central and even in the many state governments. And the next one, it is the central government announced several projects for protecting specific animals which are gravely threatened, tiger, one horned, you know, the rhinoceros and the king cat, the Kashmir stag, Indian elephant, etc. So the central government announced a particular, a specific projects for a specific animals to protect those particular animals. So it may be for tiger, or it may be for horned, you know, the rhinoceros and the Kashmir stag, Indian elephant, all this thing. And the next one, it is Wildlife Act of 1980 and 1986, several hundred butterflies, moths, beetles and dragonfly have been added to the list of protected species. So here we are seeing only the, you know, the big animals, not the other kind of small species. So here in the, you know, the Wildlife Act of 1980 and the 1986, even they started to add some small species also. And the next one, it is in 1991, for the first time, plants were also added to the list, starting with the six species. Not only the animals, even for the plants also, they started in the year of 1991 to protect the plants. Guys, you understood, right? The conservation of forest and wildlife in India, the methods we have seen, we started for the, you know, some protect activities. So here, you know, Indian Wildlife Act, and they started to conserve the animals. Along with that, they started to conserve even the plants also. Yes. You can see some of the, you know, the things are the beetles or the tiger, you know, beetles, all those things they started to conserve. Yes. The next we can see about the types of forest. So this things we have already studied in your last concept. Do you people remember what are the types? You know, the we have seen that Indian Forest Act has been started, and they started to divide the forest into different categories. Are you all remember? Just glance that. Yes. So here we can see that different types of forest. One it is reserved forest, protected forest, and the one more it is, what is that? unclassed forest. Okay, so the first one we have already studied, this reserved, protected forest, all those things. So here they are telling reserved forest, more than half of the total forest land has been declared reserved forest. These are regarded as the most valuable as far as the conservation of forest and wildlife resources are concerned. So in this particular areas or in this particular forest, the maximum land or the wildlife will be under the protection. So we can see the forest department, they will be under the, you know, protection of this forest and along with the, you know, animals also, because they have to protect from the smuggling activity, they have to protect from the threatening activities, all those things. Okay, and the next one, it is protected forest. What is the meaning of protected forest? See here, almost 1/3 of the total forest area is protected forest as declared by the forest department. This forest land are protected from any other further depletion. So here what happened, the reserve forest will not be allowed any person or the people even inside also. But here in the protected, for, you know, the forest area, 1/3 of the total forest area is protected forest. So there in the reserve forest, we have seen that half of the total forest area has been declared as a, you know, the forest reserve forest. Here 1/3 of the total forest area is protected area and it's declared by the forest department. So this, you know, the forest land are protected from any other depletion, that is, you know, any other destructions or the threatening activities, it will be protected. In the next one, it is unclassed forest. What does it mean by unclassed forest? So whatever the forest we will be seeing in your particular areas, a small, you know, it will be for 100 meters, 200 meters as a small, you know, the forest they'll be having. It will be owned by, even by the, you know, the individuals or also, or it may be by the government people also. See, these are other forests and waste lands belonging to both government and private individuals and communities. So this kind of, you know, it may be like a wasteland also, it may be like a forest also. We can see, you know, we can look around this. You just see in your neighbors, you know, what happens, there will be small forest area, like a small jungle or some small, you know, the wastelands also. So that we'll call it as a unclassed forest. So you people understood the three different types of forest. One it is reserved forest, and one more it is, yes, protected forest, and the third one it is unclassed forest. In the next one, we can see what is the role of the people, the community and the conservation, how we can do the conservation. So what happens, as we already know, it is very much important to protect the flora and fauna for our livelihood also, to live longer. So that's the reason the many people, they started to take initiative to protect that, you know, the whatever the, you know, the forest area. Here in, you know, Tariq Shah Tiger Reserve, Rajasthan, villagers have fought against the mining by citing the Wildlife Protection Act. So what happens in Rajasthan, we can see that's one of the example, the locals, the villagers and all, they started to oppose the mining activity to protect the, you know, the tiger reserves. And the next one, it is in many areas, villagers are themselves are protecting habitats and explicitly rejecting the government involvements. In few areas, what happens, the villages themselves, the locality themselves started to protect all the inhabitants of the, you know, this flora and fauna. They are not taking any of the help from the government also. The next one, the inhabitants of 5 villages in the Alwar district of Rajasthan have declared some forest areas as Bardev Bhakav and Sanctuary, declaring their own set of rules and regulations. So they have got the sanctuary, so they, you know, they started with their own rules and regulations. In the next one, you know, we can see some movements associated with the conservation of forest and wildlife. So as we think, we'll start with the, you know, protection activity, it will not be there. So that is the reason what happened, even some movements they started, even some, you know, protest they started to conserve of this forest and the wildlife. So here we can see few examples of that. See, Chipko movement in the Himalayas has not only successfully resisted deforestation in several areas, but has also shown that the community afforestation with indigenous species can be enormously successful. So here the Chipko movement which happened in Himalayas, it was not 100% successful, but partially it is successful, and it shows to the world or the other people that even with the community people we can do afforestation also. And the next one, it is the farmers and citizens group like Bleach, the Chavo Andolan in Theri and Naudhanya have shown that diversified crop production is possible without the use of synthetic chemicals. So because we already know that the usage of more and more fertilizers and the the chemical fertilizers and the pesticides, which will decline the the soil fertility, and it will start destructing some species also. So that is the reason they started to adopt this diversified crop production also. In the next, here you can see that is the Chipko movement, and the next one more, it is joint forest management also. So we have already seen about we saw that Chipko movement, and he is a Ghawali is a environmental, is one of head of the Chipko movement leader, and how it has been started. See, the modern Chipko movement started in the early 1970s in the Garhwal Himalayas of Uttarakhand with growing awareness towards rapid deforestation. It was a non-violent resistance through the act of hugging trees to protect them from falling. So here, to oppose this deforestation, they started this movement. And the next one, it is joint forest management. So the program has been informal existence after when the state of Orissa passed resolution for joint forest management. It was a good example for involving local communities in the management and the restoration of degraded forest. So they started to do some afforestation activities also. In return, members of this communities are entitled to intermediary benefits like non-timber forest producers and share in the timber harvested by successful protection. Even they started to protect. And the next one we can see, it is the sacred groves. So as India, what we will believe, we started to believe that the sacred groves, few of the plants and all is very sacred, and we Hindus, we believe the plants have got the the god or goddess, the creator, all those things. And the next one, it is nature worship. So as I already the sacred groves is linked with this nature worship. What happened, people, some tribals and people started to worship the nature. So that is the reason what happened, they started to avoid cutting of the trees and touching of that particular places. So that is the reason what happened, the people started to believe there is a god or something. See, nature worship is an age old tribal belief based on the premise that all creations of nature have to be protected. That is the one reason. The one more, it is such belief have protected many virgin forests. Yes, even now also in tribal peoples we can see they are the the main reason to protect the forest. And the Mundras and Santals of Chotanagpur region, Bha, and Karama trees, tribals Odisha and Bihar, the worship the tamarind and mango trees during their wedding. So they will be worshipping the mango and even the tamarind trees also. The sacred qualities are often ascribed to spring, mountain peaks, plant and animals which are closely protected. So the people started to believe the nature as a worship. Okay, finally guys, hope you all remember the entire concept, the reasons or the factors responsible for the depletion and the conservation of this flora and fauna is very much important. Make your own notes, use the PPT, and I'll be giving you people worksheet by the end of the day. So hope you all understood the concept. Thank you all. Enjoy the day.